In this video, we're looking at a surface of revolution formed by revolving the graph of cosh x on 0 to 1 about the y-axis. Once we set up the surface integral for this surface of revolution, it turns out that the resulting integral requires integration by parts. So you can see I've already drawn an increment of area into this surface, and that's a thin ribbon with a thickness given by an increment of arc, ds. In addition, I can say that the right end of this ribbon is at a horizontal position of x. Well, that means the radius of this ribbon is given by x. So the next thing we do is cut and unroll this ribbon, and we'll get a thin rectangle. The thickness of that rectangle is ds, and the length of it, well, that corresponds to the circumference of it when it was rolled up into a ring. So that's going to be 2 pi times the radius, which here is just 2 pi times x. We call the area of this thing dA. And that's just given by the product of length and width, so 2 pi x ds. Now we need a reminder of how to write the arc length element ds. And this is where the hyperbolic cosine curve comes into the setup. The arc length increment is given by the square root of 1 plus the derivative of the curve squared times dx. Now the derivative of cosh is just sinh, the hyperbolic sine function, and I'll post a link to the video where I derived that. Well, this means I can set up my expression for the area increment as 2 pi x ds, which is square root 1 plus sinh squared x dx. And because this is phrased entirely in terms of one variable now, I can go ahead and slap an integral sign on it and add up all the contributions. So A is the sum of all the DAs. That's what integration does. And so I have the integral as x goes from 0 to 1, 2 pi x square root 1 plus sinh squared x dx. So here I have to remember an identity for sinh and cosh. 1 plus sinh squared turns out to be cosh squared, and if I square root that, I just get the cosh function. All right, this is a classic integration by parts situation. I have this simple function x that I know will get simpler if I differentiate it, so I'm going to let that be u in my integration by parts. And then I have a second function, cosh of x, that shouldn't be hard to integrate, so I'm going to let cosh x dx be dv in my substitution. I'm also going to move the 2 pi out of this thing as I do my integration by parts. So to find v out of this, I just have to guess the antiderivative of this dv, just recalling that the derivative of sinh is cosh. So I'm going to pull my 2 pi out of there as I rewrite this thing using integration by parts. And the integration by parts formula tells me that I get a uv out of this, and that's going to be x sinh x evaluated from 0 to 1 minus the integral of v du. So it's the integral from 0 to 1 of sinh x, that's v, and the du is just dx. So I'll go ahead and evaluate that first piece across the limits of integration. When I plug in the upper limit, I get 1 times sinh of 1, so I get sinh 1 minus 0 times sinh of 0, so that's 0. Then I have this other integral piece, and I have to guess the antiderivative of sinh, which again is just cosh, and I get cosh x evaluated from 0 to 1. So this is one way to leave the answer, but it's not ideal. I can write sinh 1 minus cosh 1 plus cosh of 0. I'm pretty confident we can simplify this thing better than that by using the definitions of sinh and cosh. And I can see that sinh of 1, that would require me to replace both those x's with 1's, is going to give me a 1 half e to the 1 minus e to the negative 1. Then I look at my cosh of 1 term, and that's 1 half e to the 1 plus e to the negative 1. Remember, I'm subtracting cosh of 1, so minus 1 half e to the 1 plus e to the negative 1, which is 1 over e. And then I have cosh of 0 at the end of this expression. And replacing the x's with zeros here in the definition of cosh, I would get 1 plus 1 in the parentheses, and half of that is just 1. So when I look at simplifying these terms, I notice there's a 1 half e that's going to pop out of this first piece and a negative 1 half e out of the second piece. So those cancel, and I'm left with 2 pi distributing the 1 half in here, minus 1 over 2e, minus another 1 over 2e, plus 1, and negative 1 over 2e minus another 1 over 2e, that just gives me negative 1 over e. And I'm going to go ahead and write that after the 1 to make it look a little nicer. And there's our exact surface of revolution using integration by parts. If you find the math content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce dozens of new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.